In this video, I'm going to show how CircuitPython can be used on a Raspberry Pi Pico. This is an alternative to MicroPython that I've used on my earlier projects. I'll explain what CircuitPython is, how to install it, including a fix how to apply to the MU editor, and how to use it to control addressable RGB LEDs, or NeoPixels, as they are referred to in CircuitPython. So in this video, I'll be going through some simple examples to light up the NeoPixel LEDs, but this is an introduction for a future video where I'll explain how I use this to create a reaction-based game. So if you'd like to get notified of the next video, please subscribe and enable notifications. If you could also smash that like button at any time in the video, that would be a great help. So CircuitPython is based on the Python programming language, but it's optimised for low-power microcontroller devices. This is similar to MicroPython, though there are some differences in the way that the hardware is referenced, and code written for CircuitPython will not necessarily work with MicroPython, or vice versa. This will not be a problem if you are creating a program from scratch. You just write code appropriate to the variant you've selected, but it can make it difficult to follow guides which are designed for a different variant. And that's the main thing you need to be aware of. There are more similarities between CircuitPython and MicroPython than there are differences, so it shouldn't be too hard to switch between the two. One of the benefits with CircuitPython is the support for Adafruit products, as Adafruit do produce good support for CircuitPython across many of their different components. The reason I chose CircuitPython was because of some problems I had with controlling the NeoPixels with MicroPython. Although they mostly worked, there were some glitches when I was setting individual pixels. This could have been some kind of subtle timing issue, or it may have even been down to temperamental hardware. Instead of spending too much time on that, I decided to use CircuitPython, and I also thought that would be a great opportunity to demonstrate CircuitPython, as I haven't covered that in my videos before. First, let's install CircuitPython on the Raspberry Pi Pico. This is similar to how you'd set up MicroPython, but uses the download from the CircuitPython website. If you go to circuitpython.org, you click on Downloads and then choose the Raspberry Pi Pico. The time of creating this, the latest version is 7.3.3, which is the one at the top. There is a version 8, but it's in beta. Use the recommended stable version. So you can just click Download to download that. And this will download the file that you need to put on the Pico. While we're here, if you also want to go to the libraries and download the appropriate library bundle. And we'll go for the one that matches the version that we've just downloaded. So as it's a version 7 version of CircuitPython, click on the version 7 download. And we'll come back to both those later. Those files are finished downloading now. So you can have a look at the ones here. So the one ending UF2 is the binary CircuitPython file that we need to transfer to the Pico, and then the other is the libraries. I'll come back to that in a second. So now I'm going to connect the Pico to the computer holding down the boot select button. And this shows as a USB drive on here called RPI-RP2. You also see that there's some information on there about how to install images. And basically, we just need to take this UF2 file and drop it into there. After installing that, you'll see that the drive name changes to now be CircuitPy. You can create the code to run in here. If it's called code.py, then that code will run automatically. And every time you save to that, it'll automatically load and run. We'll see that in use a bit later. Now, as I said, we downloaded some library files earlier. If we go back to here, it's a zip file, so we need to extract that from the zip file. And you'll see there's a lot of files in here. We wouldn't want to copy all these library files to the Pico because there's so many of them and we really just don't need them. So we can just copy the ones we want. So on the CircuitPython flash drive, create a new folder called lib, and then you would copy the relevant folder or the library file. You'll see that the library files .mpy rather than .py, so these are compressed files and they're a bit smaller. So we just, for this one we'll be using NeoPixels, so we'll just use the neopixel.mpy and we'll just copy that into the lib folder. And now we can start writing code that will use that module. The recommended editor for using with CircuitPython is the Mu editor, and that's a nice, easy to use editor. But before we do that, I'm going to show you a fix for the Mu editor, and this is specific to Ubuntu Linux. If you're running a different operating system, then you can download the Mu editor from the website codewith.mu. If you're not using Ubuntu, then you can skip the rest of this chapter, and I'll catch up with you a bit later. In an earlier video, I explained about setting up Ubuntu as a dual boot machine with Windows 11. During that, I installed the Mu editor, but when I tried it, it failed. I didn't follow up on that at the time because I'd mainly been using the Thonny editor. But as Mu includes integration with CircuitPython, I wanted to fix that, or at least find a workaround. If you try and run Mu from the launcher, then you don't see the error. So to get the error, I open a terminal screen and run the Mu-editor. And here we can see the error. And the error's line 774 in the move method of the file slash user share mu editor mu interface slash main.py. We can go and edit that. We have to run a sudo so that we have root permissions. If you go to line 774, then you'll see this. And what's happening here, the screen moves using this move method and it's expected integers, but because this has got a divide by two, then this will be given a floating point number, even if it happens to fall on a integer boundary, it's still going to be floating point. So what we just need to do is to change that from a single slash, which means divide, to a double slash, which means a divide and round down. And now we can run the Mu editor. And that works now. The good news is, having looked through the latest source code, this has been fixed, along with quite a few other changes. So hopefully, future versions of Ubuntu, this should work straight away once it's been updated with a newer code. In fact, there's more in the new code, and this is a bit of an aside, but I thought we'd just take a quick look at this because I thought it was quite interesting when I looked at it myself. And look at the bottom of the file. These are the replacement for the lines we've just edited. And you'll see they've got the divide by with floor, so the divide by round down, effectively, instruction there. But if you also look, that it finishes with this if x is none, else x, and the same for the y. And this is a conditional expression, or sometimes known as a ternary operator. To understand this, start by reading at the if part. So this is saying that if x is none, i.e. that x isn't defined, then evaluate the left-hand side, as in x equals this. If x is not equal to none, i.e. we've already got a value from x, which was calculated earlier, then we just use that value of x, so x becomes equal to x. A little difficult to get your mind around at first, but particularly if you start looking from this if bit, and read that first before you consider what's happening here, then you can sort of understand that. I actually don't like the way this is worded, because I think it's far better if you put a separate if statement in that makes it easier to read. It might add an extra couple of lines of code. But you do have to be aware that this is something that other people may use in their code, and you just need to be able to recognize that if you come across it. So with the new editor working, we can use that to program the Raspberry Pi Pico. You need to check that you're in the CircuitPython mode, which you can change by using the mode button, and it should detect it straight away. One thing you may notice if you used Mu for other devices is there's no run or play or any other kind of button. Instead, whenever you save it, it will automatically start running the program as long as it's called code.py. You can click on the serial monitor to see what's happening. Right, click a save there, you see auto reload is on, so it's just started running. And this feels a bit strange at first. I often use a quick control S as a quick save whilst editing a program, even before it's ready to run. But it's something you do get used to. And if you include any print statements in your code, then you can see them on the output of this serial monitor, which is what you're seeing here. This is the circuit that I've used for this first demonstration. This is basically a NeoPixel strip, which is shown here, connected to port GP22, which is physically pin 29, if you count round, on the Raspberry Pi Pico. If you're using the power supply from the Pico, then you can only light a small number of LEDs. Also note that the NeoPixel is designed to run at 5 volt, so the data should really be fed with a 5 volt source here. In my earlier videos using the Raspberry Pi, I created voltage shift circuits to increase the 3.3 volt signal to 5 volts, but I haven't done that here. Ideally, there should be a level shifter, and in my actual project, I do use one. But as long as your lead to the NeoPixels isn't too long, then it shouldn't be an issue. You can see more details about the circuit on my website, penguintutor.com. See the link in the description. I've created two examples of code to show how you can control the NeoPixels using CircuitPython. This is the first example. This turns all the LEDs to a set color at a time. I use the pixels.fill to fill all the pixels up with that color. It then waits 10 seconds before changing to a different color. It also has print statements, which means you can see the color in the console as it changes. And this is what I use to make sure I chose the correct color sequence. In the case of my pixels, this is GRB, green, red, and then blue. If you've used MicroPython before, then you may notice that CircuitPython uses a different way to refer to the GPIO pins. In CircuitPython, use the board library from this import board, rather than machine, which is how you refer to them in MicroPython. And then I've used board.gp22 to refer to GPIO port 22. The libraries are also different to the ones used in MicroPython, but otherwise, it's still based around the same Python, so it should be fairly familiar and fairly easy to follow the code if you've done any Python programming before. Here's a second code example. It's a little bit longer, but not too much. And this one turns all the LEDs off, but then lights just one LED. And then the position of that lit LED moves from left to right and back again. And then this code is going to be the basis of my reaction-based game. There are some extra options on the NeoPixel constructor. In particular, this entry called auto_right, which is set to false. It's defaults to true, in which case, whenever you change any of the NeoPixel values, they'll automatically be written. By setting this to auto write equals false, we now have to add the pixels.show, which will update the pixels. So we set the colors to what we want and then run that, and then that will update them. And what this means is that you can prepare, set the pixels to the different colors and then just update them all in one go. And what this does, it's using the fill that we used before to set them all to 000, which is black or effectively off, and then sets the one at pixel position to 255, 255, 255, which is all red, green and blue, or effectively white. And as you can see, this is referenced using square brackets as though this is basically just a list entry. And then the rest of the code is just about moving this pixel position along and then reversing the direction and moving it in the other direction. Again, visit my website for more details, including all these source code examples, so that you can follow along if you'd like to. This has only been a very quick introduction to CircuitPython. My next video will show how you can use CircuitPython to control an LCD display using I2C. And then in a future video, I'll show you how I could put all these together along with a 3D printed enclosure I designed in 3CAD to create an LED reaction game. So what's your thoughts of seeing this so far? What do you think about the differences between CircuitPython and MicroPython? Have you tried both, or are you just sticking with one particular one? Please let me know in the comments what you think of the two different versions. Let's keep it civilized though. I'm sure there are plenty of flame wars on different programming languages elsewhere, if that's your thing. But it'd be quite useful to have a constructive discussion on here if anyone's had any previous experience of those. If any of your future plans sound interesting, please subscribe and don't forget to hit that like button to help others to find this video through the YouTube algorithm. Thanks for watching. I look forward to seeing you on a future video.